Nissan, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy. Here now, John Saunders and Jesse Palmer.
Yes, indeed, from New York City, and happy Halloween, everyone. Number one team in the nation in action, trying to do what Oregon's about to do. That remains unbeaten. Today, facing Ole Miss. And Devon Washington goes 95 yards on this kick return. This is after an Ole Miss score.
Ole Miss has scored to take it within 7 points before this kickoff return touchdown. Cam Newton also has a touchdown reception early in this game.
Michigan State facing Iowa. Mark D'Antonio back on the sidelines a couple weeks ago. But he watches as Kirk Cousins throws this to Tyler Sash. He gives it to Micah Hyde. He returns it.
Iowa's defense was big in this one. 3 turnovers. They only gave up 31 rushing yards. Iowa stays alive for a Big Ten championship.
Kirk Cousins picked off 3 times. Missouri and Nebraska. Missouri was unbeaten coming in as well. Roy Helu Jr., though, not impressed. 53 yards on this run.
Helu Jr. had 3 touchdown runs of over 50 yards on his way to a school record 307 rushing yards. Nebraska stays in control of its own destiny.
School record in Nebraska is saying something, too. Utah also unbeaten facing Air Force. Jonathan Warzeka, 11 yards on the touchdown run as Air Force comes back to tie this game at 7 apiece. Oregon. What do they have to do to remain unbeaten?
Oregon just has to continue doing what they do on offense. They have to try to slow down Matt Barkley. This has been an interesting day. We had 7 unbeaten teams coming into the day. Missouri, Michigan State both lose. Either TCU or Utah have to lose next week. The BCS picture becoming a lot more clear right in front of our eyes.
They're smiling in Boise, Ohio. Enjoy the game. We, of course, will see you once again at halftime.
Thank you, John. Keep your eye on Ohio State's Cameron Hayward today. One of the leaders in the defense, even though his sack numbers are down from a year ago, his coaches say he's still playing extremely well. Minnesota has an outstanding receiver in Dejon McKnight. He caught 3 touchdown passes last week and now has 9 for the season. This has been the Nissan pregame shift. Kickoff from Minneapolis is just moments away.
We talked about each play is of great importance. Now, we looked each other in the eye last night, and we said we would give it up for each other to win this game tonight. But let's go out there. There's no speeding tickets tonight. You play as fast as you can play, and let's attack the all night long.
Jeff Horton named the interim head coach for the Minnesota Golden Gophers. Trying to fire up the troops. He was the head coach before at Nevada and UNLV, has coached in the NFL, and there is Jim Tressel, the only man in the history of college football to win 100 games at 2 different schools. Ohio State won the toss. They'll receive David Schwerman to kick. Berry and Hall are deep for the Buckeyes. Pooch kick. Hall. Straight up the sideline. And the kicker has to knock him out of bounds near the 45.
I know Coach Horton said no speeding tickets tonight. They almost have to give one right there on that opening kickoff return. A total collapse on the coverage unit on the right side. And, you know, I know that Minnesota wants to come out and play fast and hard, but you got to play fast, hard with discipline.
Terrell Pryor needs just 2 yards for 7,000 yards in total offense in his career. He would be only the 3rd quarterback at Ohio State ever to do it. Bobby Hoying, Jr., or Bobby Hoying, number 2, he only needs 157 yards to catch him on the all-time Ohio State list. And Pryor looking for that yardage early. Throws incomplete, intended for Devere Posey.
That Ohio State offensive line is why I had such high expectations for this team coming into the season. They're led up front by their right guard, Bryant Browning, a very solid unit. Got a lot of good players that they're protecting, backs and receivers across the board. Each one of them a good player.
2nd and 10 for Ohio State from the Gopher 46-yard line. And prior to throw on 2nd down, got it out to Sanzenbacher. And Sanzenbacher may have a first down where they'll mark it to 34. He does. Posey gave him a block on the outside.
Yeah, this Minnesota defense tonight will be tested for sure. They better have their track shoes on the defensive line. Anthony Jacobs, 97, playing really good football right now. At linebacker, Gary Tinsley, 51 in the middle. You see Ryan Grant over there. We'll show him in just a little bit. It's the grandson of Bud Grant. And in the secondary, the couple of safeties, Kyle Therrett and Ryan Collado, they both lead back there.
Heron is the tailback, he gets the carry, cuts it outside, inside the 25 to the 24, nearly a gain of 10. Kyle Henderson made the tackle. Heron has taken over as the tailback, and Brandon Stain, who was sharing the duties with him earlier in the year, has pretty much become a pass receiver in this Ohio State offense.
You see the speed right now that's in the backfield of Ohio State. And Minnesota, just like in the kickoff coverage that they had, they've got to maintain discipline and spread that net across the field with yellow jerseys, or else Ohio State will outrun them.
Bourne is the fullback in the eye on first and 10. Sonsenbacher, flanker, screen racked up. That may have been a backward pass. Could be a loose ball, and it is. They're going to mark it out of bounds at the 32-yard line. So it's a loss on the play. Good coverage by Kyle Henderson. He got right in Sonsenbacher's grill in a hurry.
Yeah, the ball just kind of goes backwards. It is definitely a ball that's thrown behind the wide receiver. And you see that Ohio State early trying to get that one-on-one in open space and let their athleticism beat Minnesota's secondary.
So statistically, that is not a pass. It's a lateral. Second and long now for the Buckeyes from the 32.
Looks like they're just
as the backward pass went out of bounds, the ball should be on this hash mark.
A little technical adjustment by the officials from one side of the field to the other. They bring it to the near hash at the 31-yard line.
Well, Minnesota told us they were going to come after the quarterback and not sit back. We'll see. This is that area. Ray Bentley down there on the sidelines where they better get aggressive.
They have gotten virtually no pass pressure this year with the front four. They only have four sacks all year. Posey with a catch inside the 20 to the 18-yard line. They need to reach the 14 for a first down.
Yeah, and you know what? We're going to see a lot of in-between and no man's land. Whenever Minnesota starts to rush, they just kind of hover around the line of scrimmage. There's nothing there. Now, I know they're trying to contain Terrell Pryor, but Pryor has the ability to throw the football. He completed 16 straight balls earlier in the season. And so don't sit back there and let him just pick you apart.
And since he hurt his quad, they have shown very little desire to have him run the football. If he's going to drop back, he's going to throw unless he's forced to run. Third down, Heron. Inside the 15, they'll mark it just shy of the 13. That's going to be enough for a first down.
You know, in that game against Ohio, when he completed those 16 balls, you just sit there and you watch that on tape and you're saying, okay, this guy, he can do either or. And I know that when games get really tight in the big ball games, that Pryor has the tendency to tuck it and run. And that's okay. You know why? Because he's a great athlete and a great runner.
He is that. And he is a very, very hard worker. This is a kid who has been determined to get better during his college career. Heron trips over the 15-yard line and goes down in the backfield. Loss of a yard and a half. Let's check in with Ray.
Yeah, one thing about Terrell Pryor, you guys, is early on in the season, he struggled in the intermediate and short passes. You know, he threw the ball down the field really well. But since they've gone to more throwing in their attack, I think he's gotten a lot better and a lot more accurate on the intermediate and short throws.
Well, but like Ray, we saw in that one backwards pass trying to get it out to his wide receiver. He was off with that, and it cost him 7 yards.
Let's see if Minnesota tries to come with a blitz. Pryor is in the shotgun. Four-man rush. No pressure whatsoever. Posey and right near the sticks at the 3-yard line, he may have another first down. Kyle Henderson, the transfer from Minnesota State at Mankato, who was getting a start, made the tackle, and it will be first and goal for Ohio State.
This is a nice, tight, well-thrown pass.
Sure,
Posey
is
on time. Beautiful job of over the shoulder. That's a hard throw as well, and it's a long throw. So he's got the ability and the arm. When he's on, it's mighty hard to stop Ohio State.
Opening drive of the ball game, first and goal. Heron, deep in the eye, he'll get the carry. Heron dragging tacklers with him to about the 1-foot line. Minnesota says the ball came loose. Officials indicating it's second down.
This big offensive line, juniors and seniors up front. That old saying that if you score with your man as a blocker up front, the guy behind you with a football will score. Not sure where that ball came out there, but
it did come out.
It did come out.
Stoneburner jumped on it, but they're going to give him forward progress all the way down to the half-yard line. Heron again hits a wall and is pushed back. You don't think this is exactly what that Minnesota defense needs? A stop?
Playing downhill like this, we've seen it starting Thursday night with the Florida State game, North Carolina State. It's okay for defenses to be really aggressive at the point of attack. But that tight end, that old play action, sure makes you vulnerable.
Well, that would mean number 11, Stoneburner, if they go to the tight end. This is the 11th play of this drive. Quarterback keeper, touchdown. Well, if you've got a guy who's 6'6", 235, why not? Let the quarterback push it over.
He's just a big guy, a lot of, you know, patience, but he can push the pile with that kind of size. A nice, safe call, good call.
Ohio State takes the opening drive, goes 46 yards after the good kickoff return to take the lead, and Devin Barclay is on for the point after. Barkley looked like he took a couple of false steps before that ball was snapped. Never seen a kicker move like that before. 7-0, Ohio State. Pryor caps the drive with a quarterback keep for the score.
Football in High Definition is presented by Vizio.
Ohio State with a 7-0 lead, 9:25 to go first quarter. They have dominated this series, of course. They've won 7 in a row, 23 of the last 34. Let's check that, 23 of the last 24. And 35 of the last 37 games in this series. And Adam Weber waits his turn. It's going to be his job to throw the ball well enough to keep this club in it. Stoudemire and Bennett back. Stoudemire with a return. Whacked as he got to the 25, out at the 27. Let's go to the studio. Here's Robert Flores.
The ESPN family of networks. Penn State takes on Ohio State next week. Right now they're leading Michigan 7-0 on ESPN and ESPN3.com. And Auburn rolling over Ole Miss 44-17 in the third quarter. Cam Newton has caught a touchdown pass in this game. Mike, Craig.
Thank you, Robert. Minnesota's first possession. The Gophers start from the 26. Weber wants to throw under pressure, downfield, underneath, and caught on the short ball by Gray. Marquise Gray, who is the backup quarterback, grabs one for 35 yards on an underthrown ball. It's his first year ever playing at wide receiver, and Weber that time used his athletic skills.
Well, the coaching staff told us in the meetings that he likes to use his body. This is a very talented backup quarterback that can go up and find the football. And Weber's smart enough to know to avoid the sack, get the ball up. Gray having the athleticism to see the ball, make the adjustment in the air, pick up the reception.
Boy, and this could be bad news for Ohio State. Brian Roll, their middle linebacker, number 36, he is being helped off the field. They are already missing the weak side linebacker, Ross Holman, and his backup, Dorian Bell. They would be out without three of their top four linebackers at this point.
Yep.
If he can't come back.
So, as Jim Tressel told us, we're thin at linebacker coming into the game.
And well, they're really thin now.
And in a game where you're going to go against a passing offense, having to run around back in the secondary a lot without anybody to go back there and to rotate in, that becomes an issue.
DeLeon Eskridge is the tailback. And he'll get the carry. Nothing there. Swallowed up at the line of scrimmage. Adam Weber, the Minnesota quarterback, one of only five players in Big Ten history to pass for over 10,000 yards. That really puts him in elite company. He is the career leader on this club in touchdown passes, yards, completions, and interceptions, as you might imagine. He is the only three-time captain for Minnesota's football team. Straight back, good protection over the middle, has a man, completes it down to the 5-yard line. Tyree Urey, a junior college transfer, with his second catch of the year for 32 yards, and what a pretty pass by Weber.
It starts with the pass, getting away from Johnson, the safety. You see how Weber leads the receiver to the open spot. That's talent, that's touch, that's Urey going right where the football is. But Weber, if you don't get to him, more than likely he's going to find his receiver.
They're going to throw everything out there they've got tonight. Eskridge again, nice hole. Touchdown, Minnesota. That's a pretty good gap to open up in that Ohio State defensive wall. Elstad for the point after. That drive went 74 yards, folks, and took only 41 seconds. And the underdog Gophers are right back in it.
Don't ever read into the stats. They can be misleading.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. Find our fares online only at southwest.com. Enterprise Rent-A-Car, we'll pick you up. And Nissan, proud partner of the Heisman Trophy.
As part of the Gophers locker room here in the brand new TCF Bank Stadium on campus at the University of Minnesota, they say it's the largest locker room in football. This is a beautiful facility, absolutely first class in every description.
They have done everything that you need to do to build a foundation to have success here.
Yes.
They've got the bling. And this stadium, the way it sits and looks down into the town, it's just a fabulous setting.
Jamal Berry and Jordan Hall are deep. Minnesota has its coverage pinched to this side. Berry. Horse collar as he got to the 21-yard line. There's a flag back at the 16-yard line. Minnesota indicating it would be against Ohio State. And it is. Here's Robert Flores with an update. Robert.
All right, Mike, Taco Bell studio update. Oregon leads USC. Darren Thomas to Jeff Mayle. Touchdown, and the Ducks went for two and got it, so they lead 8-3. And then Utah, number 8 in the country, also unbeaten. They've given up 10 unanswered to Air Force and trail by 3.
Goal line, first down.
Mike, that's a trademark of Chip Kelly. He has so much confidence in his offense. He'll go for two. And he does not mind if he misses because he knows he's going to get back down there again.
He'd go for four if they'd let him. So Ohio State is backed up all the way to its 8-yard line. Heron. Nothing. And any big plays, this defense, which has been sliced up six ways from Sunday, any way they can make plays is going to fire up the rest of this team even more.
Yeah, one of the weaknesses of this defense has been that the defensive line's not been making a lot of plays. They've had to rely on other players from the secondary level to come in. So getting off of blocks like they did right there with Tinsley coming in, making a play, that's just a good, solid effort, fundamental football.
Kevin Cosgrove, the co-defensive coordinator, said we cannot sit back and just play him head up. That's not going to work. We've got to come after him. Here's the blitz. Pryor under pressure, but completes the pass up near the 20 and got it to Reed Fragel, who picks up 14 yards. So there was an example of what they're trying to do. They want to put pressure on Pryor.
Yeah, but you're looking at one of the Heisman Trophy candidates in this country, one of the most outstanding players in America, and he's a big, strong body. He can look over all of those yellow jerseys, and he's going to find a big tight end.
I said they were going to try to put pressure on Pryor.
Hey, it's trick-or-treat night.
Yeah, he may not exactly react the way you want. Aaron off the left side. Got a lead block from his fullback, Zach Boren, number 44.
You know, hey, Ray, we've been players before, and that enthusiasm you come out of the locker room with, the great pep talk by Jeff Horton, now they've got to follow that up on every snap.
Yeah, those pep talks, they last for, you know, about the first few plays, and then you got to draw on something a little deeper and then get that help from each other to try and keep and sustain that emotion. We'll see if they're able to do it.
Second and five for the Buckeyes. Heron, they string him out. Stiff arm gets him a couple of yards and drilled as he got to the 35-yard line. Solid tackle by Gary Tinsley. Big hit at the end. He is their leading tackler with 63 stops this year.
You know, you got to have great effort to get to the ball. You never know if you're going to be the guy to make the play. And Tinsley certainly is one of those guys bringing it.
Aaron, 8 carries already, 27 yards on the night. Pryor, good protection, throws underneath. That won't get him anything to Stoneburner, the tight end. He may lose a yard.
There's an example of not really getting pressure to the quarterback, rushing forward, just trying to keep Pryor in the backfield and contain him, and then finding the underneath receiver. I'm always watching linebackers and safeties to see if they match up and hug up to receivers that come into their zone.
This is a defense that is 100th in scoring defense in the country out of 120 teams, giving up almost 32 points a game. They have not been stout, to say the least. Heron on the draw. Spins off the tackle, taken out of bounds. Knocked down by Keenan Cooper, the weak side linebacker, right at the sticks, but it's enough for a first down.
That was a nice run by Heron, but I really am impressed every time I watch Ohio State, their offensive line. I spent time with Jim Tressel 2 springs ago and watched them practice and the technique and their fundamentals. And when you want to watch and learn about how to be an offensive lineman, I just sit back and I listen to Jim Tressel and his staff and the way they coach there. They teach guys how to play the game.
And this offense always looks the same. And they just execute. Heron, nice cut to avoid a couple of tacklers, but Minnesota swarming on defense. They get him at the 48-yard line. Good stop chasing the play. Brandon Kirksey, number 96, from his tackle spot.
You know, tonight I'll expect yellow jerseys to get overlapped and to lose their lane assignments many times. But one thing that they can never lose, and that would be the effort war. They can give 100% effort whether they're in the right lane or not.
To a man, all the coaches we talked to said these kids have been great. They have hustled, they have practiced, they have studied. The one thing they have not done is lacked in effort. Pryor out in the flat, that's going to go nowhere as he got it to Sain, and Sain was again hit in the backfield. You can tell that this Minnesota defensive club has done its film work by how quickly they're getting to some of these receivers.
That's the way that you're able to stop the receivers when they're out there. You better get to them before the ball is caught and up the field. Now, Pryor's got to make an adjustment with his throwing out to those receivers. He's got a couple of them he's thrown behind. He's got to get it out in front like a toss pitch.
That tackle from Kyle Ferrett, who was the only returning starter on the entire defense from a year ago. The other 10 are new. Pryor back to throw, a blitz coming. He's going to take off. Pryor's got the first down, got a block. And taken out at the 20-yard line. I think philosophically, they do not want Pryor to run. But when he is challenged like that and they can't tackle him, he is going to take off. That time he picked up 30.
Okay, watch the defensive line, how they do some crossing stunts up front, right? So they've crossed and they're trying to trick the offensive line. They trick themselves. Pryor felt it, bailed out, and that is the additional weapon that he brings that defenses just cannot account for.
Posey was tying up his man downfield to give Pryor an additional 10 yards. First and 10 at the 21. They show blitz again. Pryor with time out in the flat to Posey. He'll pick up about 5.
Isn't it something that two of the best players in America play quarterback? Both of them have big bodies. Both of them wear number 2. Both of them lead great football teams. Cam Newton at Auburn, Terrell Pryor at Ohio State. They just are remarkable that athletes with that size can do what they do.
And not just have the big booming arm. They've got the touch. They understand the game.
Yeah.
Second and a long 5. Heron trying to get to the outside and does. Inside the 10, that's going to be a first down. It'll be first and goal at the 9.
Well, to this point in the season, you know, both of these guys have been spectacular on the field. Look at that. I mean, just, I think Cam Newton probably runs a little harder than Pryor. Not, it's not that Pryor couldn't, but Cam Newton has taken on the idea of, I'm in the SEC and I'm going to become the new Tim Tebow. I'm going to bull you over.
And Auburn is rolling again tonight, 44-17.
Wow.
Heron, by the way, averages 15 rushes a game. He already has 11 in the first quarter tonight. And Heron out of the Wildcat. Up the middle, 5, down to the 4. You can hand it to him or snap it to him. Let's go to Ray.
You know, Minnesota is continuing to try and be aggressive on defense. They're bringing those blitzes. And the one big play where Pryor broke it, they were bringing 2 off of that song side. He recognized that, Craig. And I think that's one thing that he has gotten better at is his field of vision. That's helped him create bigger plays and be more rounded as a quarterback.
Yeah, no question about that. If you're going to blitz, you better get to him, get to his legs in the backfield before he takes off.
Pryor under center, play action fake. Corner of the end zone, touchdown. He got Sain out of the backfield wide open in the corner and hit him. That's the 5th receiving touchdown for Sain this year, and Pryor made that look easy. He's only been 7 for 7 since missing his first pass. Barkley.
14 balls in the hole. 23 Barkley.
For the point after. And it's 14-7 Buckeyes. Ohio State has had the ball twice. And they have driven it right down Minnesota's throat twice. After his win last weekend, Denny Hamlin only 6 points behind Jimmy Johnson. Now the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the Amp Energy Juice 500 at Talladega on ESPN tomorrow at 1 o'clock Eastern. 6 points. And Harvick's only 62 back as well. Denny Hamlin certainly make it interesting. Bennett and Stoudemire, the deep men. And this will go out of bounds. Big break from Minnesota. They get the ball to 40-yard line. Uncharacteristic mistake by the Buckeyes on special teams.
Kicking team. Ball will be placed at the 40-yard line. First down.
Thanks to our friends at EA Sports, the James game breaks down Ohio State's defensive line. Craig?
I really like this 97 Cameron Hayward. Now, if you're not at the point of attack doing proper technique and footwork, Hayward will get in the backfield and it's all over with. But if you focus so much on Hayward, one of his teammates comes through and does their job. Dexter Larrymore, for example, he can play well. This isn't about any one individual at Ohio State. I'm impressed with the 11-man unit of the Buckeyes.
Brewer hit two big passes on that first drive that ended up with the touchdown, and Eskridge will take it up to the 42-yard line. Brian Roll back in there at his middle linebacker spot makes the tackle.
You know, Mike,
and that is going to be the last play of the first quarter.
And, you know, we show you the EA today to talk about this Ohio State defense. Statistically, they're ranked so high, basically one across the board in the Big Ten.
Absolutely.
But it's just not one guy, and we'll follow Hayward and his troops today to see how they do.
And they're in the top 10 nationally in every major category as well on defense. Back after this. Ready to start the second quarter here. On campus at Minnesota in their beautiful two-year-old stadium, TCF Bank Stadium, that holds almost 51,000. Did a magnificent job on this place. First new stadium in the Big Ten built in 50 years. Eskridge, the tailback, on second and seven. Play action fake by Weber and a good one. Down the middle, complete to the 20-yard line. Weber with another strike. Dejon McKnight. Weber is 3 for 3 for 104 yards. How's that for a start?
Dejon McKnight is one of those players that is explosive and learning, a former basketball guy that can get up and get down the field. And you're seeing that there's nobody in the middle of the field to help on these receivers. And Adam Weber is definitely going to find him. If you're not back there with help, he's throwing it to the open spot. He's throwing it to where most of the time a safety is back there helping out.
He's completed three passes, 35, 32, 36 yards. No wonder he's thrown for more than 10,000. Pressure coming. This time they got him. Back at the 26-yard line, a loss of 5.
Pretty good company.
And Williams combined for that stop, by the way.
Pretty
Boy,
good company,
it
isn't it?
It sure is.
That's impressive. And he's taken most every snap, what, over the last 3 years. Just a couple that he hasn't.
And he's only about 155 yards short of Chuck Long right now. Could have a future on Sunday. He is not a big, strong-arm guy, but he's a very smart, very competent quarterback under pressure. Screen. DeJuan Bennett swallowed up, and Ohio State did a great job diagnosing that. First, they got pressure, and then they messed up the screen. Kekwon Sweat, the corner and the linebacker.
Mike, as soon as the play is called and I see the screen, I'm thinking this is a great play coming. But I forgot that you've got Ohio State's defense over there, that they're smart, too. Did they go get the football?
Boy, and did Minnesota miss a couple of blocks. They just whiffed on guys.
Yeah, it's, as soon as those linebacker levels saw what was going on there, Sweat and company were in fast pursuit.
Third and 15. Right now, you would be in field goal range. So they'll go with something conservative. And we'll get something significant out of it down to the 17-yard line. Eskridge just kept picking his way. They need to get to the 11 for a first down. Here comes the field goal unit.
I like the idea, though, of what they called there. Why? Because they're having success, a shot at scoring points on every drive. And they know that Ohio State, we've seen Ohio State's offense, what they're doing. So
Trying to put points on the board every time you have it.
Elstead, who is 9 out of 11 this year in field goal tries, will set up from 35 yards away. And hits a line drive off the post. Boy, that's a tough break for Minnesota. They make that drive, get another big pass play out of Adam Weber, and come up empty. It's TV's number one comedy and the number one family everyone feels a part of. This all-new Modern Family has a moment so outrageously funny you want to be the first to see it. Modern Family, all-new Wednesday, 9, 8 Central Time on ABC. Elstead had a chance to cut it to 4 points and cranked one off the upright, so Ohio State gets possession at its own 20. Pryor, nice play action fake. Throws on the run. Posey with a catch at the 39-yard line.
Well, we have seen several really nice, well-thrown timing balls by Terrell Pryor. And he's got total confidence in Posey. That ball is in the air at the same time that the left foot is in the ground to turn out.
Bryant Browning, number 70, was his escort on that roll to the right. He's hit 8 out of 9, 65 yards so far. And this is Jordan Hall, the sophomore from Gannett, Pennsylvania, the same hometown as Terrell Pryor, getting a chance to carry the football a little bit.
What a day of football, Mike. Unbelievable. Michigan State, Missouri going down. Auburn making a statement against Ole Miss, who many thought would show up and challenge them.
Pryor blitz coming. Sonsenbacher out in the flat, taken out at the 47-yard line. Yeah, every time you turn around, it was another stunner, wasn't it?
Tulsa beating Notre Dame.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, hello, darling.
Third and 2 now for Ohio State. It's a tough situation for a defense to say, okay, we're going to be really aggressive here, because there's so many options on 3rd and 2. Pryor with plenty of time floats it down the middle. Sonsenbacher taken down at the 14-yard line. Theret, the strong side safety, was there, but Sonsenbacher was wide open. And Pryor hit him for 39 yards.
It's Halloween weekend, trick-or-treat night, and both teams now have had the luxury of throwing down the middle of the field, Ray Bentley, without a safety back there helping. Safety came up thinking run, and, boy, it's mighty hard to cover when you've got that much green monster out there to run to.
I don't understand why they're not covering the middle, Craig. I guess it is Halloween.
I know if you were the D.C., you'd have somebody back there.
I'd be going crazy right now.
Pryor going to keep it himself, gets out of bounds.
Jim Tressel, he did tell us, I hope my ball club goes on the road and plays well. You know, last year with the Purdue, this year they're just kind of not done well on the road. And you can learn a lot from getting beat. Wisconsin may have taught them a lot.
It's a lesson you don't want to learn, but you're right. You want to get something out of it.
And it's young. I mean, right now, I think Ohio State's in the driver's seat of the Big Ten.
Blitz coming. Down to the 6-7-yard line goes Jordan Hall, the high school teammate of Terrell Pryor. Zach Boren threw him a good block and got middle linebacker Gary Tinsley out of there.
You know what I'm impressed with in watching this game? The first two Ohio State drives, 11 plays, 46 yards, 6.5 minutes. Second series, 13 plays, 92 yards, both for touchdowns. They're not being over anxious. They're just playing the game.
Another 3rd and 2. They need to reach just the 4-yard line for a first down. And they're not going to get it, as Hall could not get past the line of scrimmage. Keenan Cooper, number 4, The weak side linebacker was there to drag him down.
Now I think what you're going to see is the left guard as he pulls and comes around. Boren just can't quite get up in there to clear the way, and the penetration comes in. Like you said, Mike, when Kenan Cooper dove in hard, it's a nice play by this Minnesota defense.
So Barkley will come on to try a 23-yard field goal. And this Minnesota defense has been pounded pretty good all year long. Happy to settle to make Ohio State kick a three-pointer instead of getting another touchdown. 17-7 with 8:24 to go. First half, we are in Minneapolis.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. Find our fares online only at southwest.com. Chrysler and Rogue Skyline. On November 12th, our first encounter will be our last stand.
In the beginning, that pumpkin grown in Minnesota weighed more than 1,200 pounds. In the end, the carver Michael Rudolph turned it into something very festive. The pumpkin was grown by Travis Gienger, 1,200 pounds.
That's awesome. That is amazing. A little dental work required, but other than that, it is fantastic.
Think of all the pies you can get out of that baby.
Wow.
Put a big old candle in there.
17-7 Ohio State with 8:24 to go first half. You get the feeling that Minnesota is going to have to score virtually every time they have the ball to have a chance.
Boy, you're on it tonight, partner.
Gray and Bennett fight for the ball, still loose. Bennett has it and pays the price.
Let's go to Robert Flores. Robert?
All right, Mike, here's what's happening on SportsCenter right now. Penn State leads Michigan 14-7. Evan Royster, a couple of touchdown runs. Also became the school's all-time leading rusher, surpassing Kurt Warner. And the Rangers lead the Giants 4-0 in the top of the seventh in game three of the World Series, but the Giants still lead 2-0.
All right, Robert, thanks. Starting from the 17, the Golden Gophers of Minnesota. Eskridge is the tailback. Comes off the right side, had a nice hole there for a second. Dives out to the 22. Time for our Aflac trivia question. What national championship winning coach was born on Halloween in 1951? Good luck. Craig, you didn't get this at the production meeting, did you?
I did.
Did you really?
Yeah. And it literally has to be the first that I've ever gotten. I did get a little bit of a help. Somebody gave kind of a clue.
Oh, well, then it doesn't count. You're still 0 forever. Weber, who hasn't missed tonight, just did. Throwing for Bennett out of the backfield. He got turned around, the ball down around his ankles.
You know what?
Weber's been much better on passes down the field, 30, 35 yards.
No question. And when he, but when he has a chance on something like this, he's got to hit it. There's got to be a positive game when you have the ability to get rid of the ball into a blitz.
When they're asking the offensive coaches to get Signet playing a little bit faster for them. And there is the man who's now calling the plays for the last 2 weeks, Thomas Hammack, the co-offensive coordinator, who has a bubbly personality and really looking for his kids to succeed here. And they wanted to set up the screen to Dejon McKnight, but he was covered totally by Travis Howard, who just followed him in the backfield, and then he threw it at his feet. Well, there's a receiver in the area. I don't know how it could be grounded.
There is no penalty for an intentional grounding. Number six was in the area coming back to the ball.
That's also the decision they made.
Absolutely. Well, Coach Hammack might come to the conclusion that the screens are not going to be fooling Ohio State. Go to something else in the playbook.
Not so far. You need a different mask for Halloween. Oreski with the first punt of the game. Jordan Hall is deep, waiting at the Ohio State 33. Oreski only averaging 37.7 yards a kick this year.
Ooh,
there is a good one. Looking for a block, breaking a tackle. Hall has a convoy to the five, knocked out of bounds at the one. 71 yards after a beautiful 48-yard kick.
Special teams did not do so well against Wisconsin. This was an area where this team wanted to get up and get back on track with. An outstanding punt. Look how it pins the return man. It is an excellent job of putting the return man at a disadvantage. It's just that Minnesota's pursuit guys coming down did not converge on the ball carrier and tackle him.
And Ohio State will start from the two.
That'll pick up the average of Jordan Hall from 26 per.
Yes, it will. Well, Ohio State had averaged 71 yards a drive. This one will not be that far. Play action fake Pryor. And it's intercepted. Pryor never saw Ryan Collado, who was waiting in the end zone. He pumped it, and when you have that little room to run, if you pump it once, you better not throw it to the same place.
Two things that Jeff Horton asked his guys to do was to play fast, right? Is to go for it and to give all you have. Okay, so let's go back one play where great effort takes place on the football field by one individual going across. You're thinking, oh, well, they're going to score the next play, right? Wrong. You never know. Never take anything for granted as a football player. Outstanding teamwork by Minnesota.
Tyree Urey was the backup tight end who made that play on special teams. Then they get the pick in the end zone, and instead of giving up the easy touchdown, Minnesota's got the ball back. Eskridge. Nowhere to go. Stop shy of the 5-yard line. Really the first mistake that Pryor has made tonight. And it was a big one.
And you wonder, with his running ability, if he can't prance in for a touchdown. I know he had a thigh, you know, Ray, he decided to throw it and not run it.
Yeah, guys, I think that was one of those look before you leap deals where Terrell Pryor thought he had something. His head went down. He had his eyes off the situation. Kind of reverted back to his old days where his athleticism would take care of everything instead of making good decisions, and that cost him.
Weber to the end zone. And he's got almost a first down on a perfect throw to Gray. And it is a first down. Taken down by Aaron Gant, who's now working at one of the starting safety spots. Marquise Gray out of Indianapolis, huge receiver at 6'4", 230. He is, in case you joined us late, the backup quarterback.
A nice
route. They were so thin at wide receiver, they had to move him.
So what? You know what, Mike? I like this. Put him in the game.
Sure.
He's a good athlete. Put him on the field. Play him.
If he's one of your best players, make sure you find a way to get him out there.
Back to the ground game on first and 10. And this has sort of been a two-headed offense this year. They either go with a couple of tight ends and a couple of backs and try to pound it, or they come out, spread the field, try to throw it. And they have a player down right now.
Yeah, I think that's DeLeon.
It's Eskridge, yeah.
Running back. But you see, as we showed you in the EA Sports video, Larry Moore, number 72 in that defensive line, the push that they have, just they disrupt the rhythm of a running game.
You know, you can understand why they would do it as far as Minnesota's offense, but they look right now very predictable in their offensive call. When run it on first down, think about throwing the screen. When they first came out, that opening first series, maybe even the second series, it was, hey, what can we do?
But by running it,
Ray, and you know, you play defense. By running it like they have and the threat of it, it's taken a safety out of the middle of the field for some nice throws.
Yeah, you have to be able to run the ball to open up other things. But one thing that they like to do is get that tight end, Eric Lair, involved. Haven't seen much of that yet today, and I think they're missing that because he's a huge part of this offense.
Ray, he's caught 29 passes this year and certainly one of the top three guys along with McKnight and Gray. Weber sets in the pocket, good protection, throws too high, intended for Gray. He was covered by Jermail Hines. He's done a good job this year as the nickelback for Ohio State.
But again, they bunch this time, Minnesota does, to the left side. And I think if Weber were a little more patient and would have let the passing lane open by two more steps, he could have thrown to a lot of green open field.
Well, he's got to throw to at least 10 yards of it right now. That's Jeff Horton, the interim head coach. The only man on the staff that had head coaching experience when they fired Tim Brewster after a terrible start to this season, and flags and whistles everywhere on this play.
Yep.
I'm out. Minnesota.
And Minnesota got a timeout before they were penalized for that. 5 minutes, 11 seconds to go in the half. Gophers and the Buckeyes here in Minnesota at 17-7. Time winding down in the first half of Ohio State on top of Minnesota 17-7. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary. Terrell Pryor's already had a big first half, nearly 150 total yards, a couple of touchdowns. Did have the big mistake, however, as he threw the interception on first and goal from the two. And Eskridge got the Minnesota touchdown on a 7-yard run. The Gophers also had a field goal attempt to hit one of the uprights, or it would be 17-10. They face a third and 10 here. Four-man rush, Weber with time. Tries to dump it off. Bennett was open, but it may have been tipped at the line of scrimmage, and it's incomplete.
Ohio State wasn't going to let someone run down the middle of the field without having a bracket on them that time. They made sure safeties were back and linebackers were hugging the middle of the field. That was good coverage.
Oreski, who got burned on a really good punt last time by Jordan Hall's exceptional return, is back to punt it again. Pretty good kick, takes a Minnesota bounce. Down to the Ohio State 38-yard line. 44-yard kick, no return. Buckeyes ball when we come back. Got our Aflac answer. The question was, what national championship winning coach was born on Halloween in 1951? The answer is Nick Saban. How about that? Unless you already know that, you can't know it.
Well, you just start thinking about those national championship coaches. That's how I got to it.
Ohio State takes over at its own 38-yard line. Heron. Nice hole off the left side. Heron off to the races. 40, 37 yard line in Minnesota. Finally taken down by Stoudemire, who has been switched from wide receiver to defensive backs because they're so thin over there.
This is another breakdown. There have been three or four different assignment breakdowns. You see the balling up. That's a good job by this Ohio State front and their fullback of walling off, but Minnesota just can't get caught out of their lanes.
They ended up having two guys in the same hole, and they just got pinched. Pryor, plenty of time. Cuts it back, and Terrell Pryor down to the 33, gain of 5. Here's Robert Flores.
All right, Mike, studio update brought to you by, well, brought to you by me. It's Mark Tyler. Short touchdown run for USC, and they're leading number 2 Oregon at the Coliseum 17-15, 7 minutes and change in the second quarter.
back here at 17-7. Ohio State driving, second and five. Heron again. Big hole up the middle, cuts back inside the 20. Heron still on his feet to the 16-yard line, gang tackled there. Well, they have opened up a couple of big holes in the offensive line on this drive.
Oh, his nickname is Boone Heron. I like the Boone part. Watch how patient he is. And as soon as Heron gets there, right off the block of Mike Brewster, number 50, the center, just a beautiful job of being patient and then exploding and knowing where the next level guy's coming from.
Hey, you don't have to boom anybody if you go the first 5 yards without being touched. Like that.
Ooh, there was a boom.
A boom there as he gets down to the 10. Boren, the fullback, with another good block for him.
Ray, I tell you what, this old ground game starting to set in on the Minnesota defense.
Yeah, it really is. So you can tell from down here, you're starting to get some bad body language from the Gopher defense. A lot of hands on hips, and guys aren't quite as, I don't know, into it, as intense as they were early on.
Heron has already hit 15 carries, 99 yards. That's number 16. And he gets down to the 6. That's right at the sticks where they give him a mark. It looks like it's going to be another first down for the Buckeyes. And Heron has already gone over 100 yards.
Thanks in large part to Zach Boren, that number 44 fullback. He's dominating right now.
Mm. Nice lead fullback, 252 pounds. Mm. Chucks it right up in there.
Yeah, I see those hips on the hands in the middle there, Ray.
They are not very
hands
deep.
Hips.
Defensively, they are very inexperienced. There aren't a lot of things they can do because of their youth. Whistles will kill this play. And this may have been a delay of game. It was.
Offense, number 2. 5-yard penalty. The down remains first.
So that'll be first and goal from the 10. Remember the last time they were down here was first and goal at the 2. And Pryor threw an interception at the goal line.
Well, that penalty right there also allows another couple of minutes for that defense to pick
it
up
does.
Some wind and get their legs back before the next snap.
Any little delay helps when you're that exhausted. Clock running inside of 2 minutes, and now it'll stop. Ohio State takes a timeout with 1:44 to go in the half. We'll step aside and be back right after this.
Please.
Coming up, the Capital One halftime report. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer will give you all the scores and highlights. Well, it was another very busy day in college football. And just chock full of surprises as usual. First and goal, Buckeyes from the 10. Heron. All that room to run, and Heron is in. Touchdown. Holy cow, there was nobody on the left side. How do you get that wide open on a running play, Craig?
Well, I think it's another assignment bust by Minnesota's secondary. Safety's supposed to come up and have the in-man line of scrimmage to make sure everything stays on the inside. Ohio State goes too tight. It's a power deal, and once you get inside them, their leverage, when they have the ability to block down on you, they're going to get you.
Barclay comes on for the point after. And knocks it through, and it's starting to get away from the Gophers as they have fallen behind 24-7.
Yeah, I think, you know, just at the top of the screen, the safety comes up and he loses. He gets stuck inside like an inside linebacker. And Ray, you know, when you do that and there's nobody outside to turn them back inside, it's easy for a running back.
The numbers on Heron. He's had a tremendous first half with 114 yards average, 6.7 yards a carry.
You know, what impresses me about this team is and a lot of things, but one of them on the ground is that they have overpowered their opponents
over the last 13, now 14 games, nearly 3-1 on the ground. So they're about 226 yards a clip rushing, and their opponents coming in at about 82. That just sends a message. You're dominating people.
The Wisconsin game was the only hiccup. They got hit in the mouth by the Badgers in that one. And Minnesota will get the ball out to about the 32-yard line. Brandon Kirksey, defensive lineman, took it on the hop and used his 280, 290 pounds to move it right back up the middle. Well, better than 2-1 time of possession so far, Craig, for Ohio State.
And you know what? The mentality, Jeff Horton said, nothing to lose. Come out and throw the ball. You try to go down the field and score points. Don't be conservative.
Weber with time. That's exactly what he's going to do. And overthrew the closest guy to it, Devon Torrance, the Ohio State defensive back. This week on ESPN's Monday Night Football, Peyton Manning and the Colts out for revenge. They lost in week one to their AFC South rivals, the Texans. ESPN's Monday Night Football, Texans and Colts, 8:30 Eastern. Coverage starts at 7 Eastern. Monday Night Countdown served by Applebee's.
I had fun last week at the Giants-Cowboys game on Monday night.
The Cowboys didn't.
They didn't show up. I thought about running down and playing a little quarterback. Love to see Arian Foster and see if he can run against that Colts defense again like he did in game one.
He can run against any defense. Weber, there's another screen. This one they get to Bennett. And Bennett will pick up about 7 before Torrance got him. And Torrance is still down.
Boy, coming in from the side there, and Torrance put his head in low on those legs and probably got drilled right in the helmet
of
the knee or
something like that.
Yeah.
And there's a flag down as well. We haven't heard what that is yet. Torrance, a senior from Canton, Ohio, was a minor league baseball player for a couple of years in the summer. And he ducks that head.
Yep.
That's exactly what happened. And you just can't do it. You have to see what you hit.
I really believe that we've got to get back to teaching tackling lead with
play,
the shoulder.
Illegal block in the back. Offense number 73, 10 yards from the spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
You know, the old time, Mike, they didn't, I mean, people were hitting hard back then, but they were leading
sure.
with shoulders and not leading with a helmet. And that it's just, these helmets cannot protect the brain
no.
at the pace and the speed that they're going with it right now. Shoulder pads can help it, a shoulder, but that head is just cannot take it.
Yeah, your brain is still stuck inside that helmet. It shouldn't be used as a weapon for your protection, not somebody else's necessarily. Mark the ball back at the 23-yard line. Eskridge will try to get outside. Turns the corner and goes out of bounds at the 31.
Ray, you know what? You know, you play defense. I mean, what do you think about that? Teaching really more leading with the shoulder.
Yeah, I coach young kids. And I have done it for the last 5-6 years, Craig, and that's the number one thing you have to teach them is keep your head up. And what that does, it allows you to not only see what you're going to hit, but it bulls the deck. So that'll take and absorb some of that shock. Where you get in trouble is you drop your head. Not only is that bad technique, you can't see what you're hitting, but you're also at risk for injury. So I think it starts at the young age to teach those habits.
1 minute exactly to go first half, third and long. For Weber, another screen. And this one will only work for about 5 yards. To Bennett. He's taken down by Cameron Hayward, the son of the great Ironhead Hayward, the Steelers running back, who could have been a first round draft choice a year ago, chose to come back, said he wanted to be with his teammates and wanted to become a better ball player. And even though some of his numbers are down, he is a sensational player.
Hey, how about it, though? You know, if you're at Ohio State and you're sitting there and you're thinking, I can come back and be a part of a great football team, can get closer to finishing my education. I mean, this isn't like you're, you know,
This is Ohio State University, and all of these guys, when they get out of football, which is going to be sooner than later, you and I understand the significance of having that degree and what that does for your life forever.
Yeah, mine's somewhere.
I got mine hanging on the wall. I'm proud of that rascal, I promise you. So my wife encouraged me. I had to go back and finish it up, but I'm glad I did. So Hayward and these guys who come back and play, if you're that good, it's going to be there waiting on you. Sunday and those checks will be there waiting on you.
Well, you probably worked for yours. Shanked punt out of bounds to the 48-yard line.
That's
right off the side of the foot of Oreski for 11 yards, and this is going to give Ohio State another shot at scoring.
Which is why Jim Tressel called timeout to make sure he saved clock, had timeouts, either on a return or a bad punt.
Just in case.
And I can tell you, as a former punter, what happens is you try to directionally kick the ball and to pin the receiver, the punt returner down there. And when you turn your body and you start making those angle adjustments to punt the football, it can mess you up with your drop.
Things are starting to go bad for the interim head coach and the rest of his staff. Pryor gets it out to Sonsenbacher. He's pushed out of bounds near the 40. He'll mark it at the 39. His third grab with 30 seconds to go in the half.
See how well Terrell Pryor threw that football into the face of a blitz, knowing exactly the route where it was supposed to be. I'm very impressed with what Pryor's doing throwing the ball
tonight. Absolutely. Ohio State with one timeout remaining. Pryor's 11 out of 13. 120 yards on the night. Minnesota showing blitz. Boy, are they ever. They got everybody up there.
Empty middle field.
And Pryor going for it. Hangs it up. Posey, touchdown. Posey beat Stoudemire, who never saw the ball. And Pryor did the right thing. He had one-on-one coverage. His man had an advantage, and he just threw it up there and told Posey to go get it.
Well, you have an immediate lack of experience with Stoudemire. Here, coming into this season, was a kick return guy and a wide receiver. So when the ball's up in the air like that, not having the experience of really turning around, playing the ball in the air, all of those mechanics against you.
His speed and his athletic ability got him there. That's why they moved him back to the corner. But the lack of technique to be able to turn around and see the ball over your shoulders would burn him. Barkley again. So the poor punt leads to a two-play 47-yard drive and a touchdown.
Yeah, let's go back and we'll look at it. And you see Posey, look at it, at the work towards the middle of the field. Why did Stoudemire take that bait? Because nobody was in the middle of the field to help him. He had to respect the move towards the middle that Posey, when he put that foot in the ground, it drove him off his hips, turned the hips, and from that point on, nice route by Posey and an equally nice, impressive throw by Terrell Pryor.
Smiles all around on the Ohio State sideline as what was once a close ball game is now a 31-7. First half shellacking for the 11th-ranked Buckeyes.
With great balance by Ohio State, they've run the ball for 168 yards and they've thrown for 158. Total 326 yards.
And they know what happened this afternoon with Iowa just blasting Michigan State, getting them right back in the Big Ten race, right back in the BCS race. Checking with Robert Flores in the studio. Robert.
All right, Mike, here's an update on the AT&T Player of the Week. Here's a fascinating nominee in Roy Hello Jr. of Nebraska. 307 yards, a single game school record as Nebraska beat Missouri 31-17. To take part, vote. Text vote to 345-345 for a chance at a trip to the national championship.
If you set the single game rushing record in Nebraska, you have done something, buddy.
Against the number six team?
Yes, sir. Minnesota with Eskridge trying to break one, and Eskridge takes it out to the 48-yard line. Gain of 20. And and Minnesota will stop the clock at that point.
Absolutely. You've got a chance to throw maybe a 10, 15-yard ball, timeout again, then put one into the end zone.
Let's take a look at this week's BCS standings. They're brought to you by the Discover Card and Auburn lumping Ole Miss tonight, or in fact, it is a final 51-31. Oregon, it says, with the lead against USC. Boise State, TCU, Michigan State, that will change. How far will the Spartans fall after that thumping? Missouri also clobbered. How far will they go? Alabama will move up, maybe to fifth. Then Utah, Oklahoma, and Wisconsin. Wisconsin and Alabama both had the day off. Having the day off sounds pretty good.
Wow.
Not too many bad things can happen to you. Can Minnesota do anything to get into scoring territory here with only 10 seconds to go? Four-man rush. Weber, Chase, throws. Picked off at the sideline. Intercepted by Chimdi Chekwa, his third pick of the year. Tough to blame Weber for that. He's just trying to throw it downfield and pick up some yardage.
This is where the receivers just got to go fight as hard as a defensive back for the football. And it just a poorly thrown ball and only a four-man rush, too. I thought Weber should have stayed in the pocket a little bit better, but he didn't, and he broke out and threw a ball up for grabs.
So Ohio State will regain possession with 3 seconds to go.
Boy, wasn't it just a couple of seconds ago that the score was like 17-7?
It seems like it. Doesn't seem that long ago. It was 7-7. Ohio State will kill the clock and go to the locker room at the half. Our score, Ohio State 31, Minnesota 7. Stay tuned for the Capital One halftime report. John Saunders and Jesse Palmer after these messages. Welcome back to ESPN on ABC Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines. 31-7 at the half. Close for a while. Minnesota said they were going to come out, let it fly. They did early. Didn't last.
14 points in the last minute, 19 seconds. So, I mean, Minnesota came out and they gave great effort. They executed. They had effort and enthusiasm to go with it. They had some breakdowns, though, in execution. And Ohio State being such a good football team, when you make a mistake, they have found it. Every time tonight, Minnesota was out of their lane, Ohio State got them.
Do you know you have a spider on your shirt?
You know what? Cleaners told me they may give me a little special this week, you know. So, hey, here we are in the spirit of Halloween. We're about to trick-or-treat, and I know my friend back in New York, Jesse Palmer, I know that he's going to have a suit on before long. So I thought I'd just beat him to it with a little bit.
I mean, that's not real.
Yeah, I hope it's not real.
Well, Minnesota will get the ball to start the second half. Interim head coach Jeff Horton got a good first half performance out of Adam Weber as quarterback. Came out, hit his first three passes for over 100 yards. Set up a touchdown drive. It was 7-7. But then the adrenaline seemed to wear off. Stoudemire and Bennett are the deep men for Basil. Stoudemire. He's got speed across the 30. Out of bounds near the 40. The kicker, Drew Basil, took him out of bounds. Let's take a look at our Pacific Life game summary for the first half. And after a good start for Minnesota, Ohio State dominated with 326 yards, nearly double what the Gophers racked up in 170, and time of possession was better than 2-1.
I like the balance of Ohio State's offense and their football team. Again, I'm very impressed with the execution and the focus of what they've done here tonight.
Eskridge off the right side, nothing there. You got to hand it to Jim Tressel. I mean, the man consistently has produced quality teams at Ohio State, one after the other after the other. And when you read any article that says, hey, these guys aren't quite good enough to win the Big Ten or quite good enough to win a national championship, it seems to be so much nitpicking to me.
7-10-win seasons, and like I'm talking about tonight, hey, coming into a place like this where a team had nothing to lose, a dangerous opponent.
Weber after a good play action fake again down the middle, and again the completion to Marquise Gray. He's a big target. He's a very talented athlete, and they're using the backup quarterback as a wide receiver. That's the fourth completion Weber has had tonight of more than 30 yards.
Well, now there's a safety deep on this one, Mike. Watch now as the ball is thrown. It's underthrown to the receiver who comes back to it. So I would say that the safety on that play, Johnson, would more than likely be asked by his coach tomorrow, come on up a little bit crisper on that ball.
Good throw by Weber, though, to get the ball there before the safety did close. First and 10 from the 25. Eskridge will try the left side. This is a very right-hand oriented running game. They have not done well going to the left. They normally like to pull their left guard. Chris Bunders, he appears to be the most athletic guy on that front wall. He gets out in front. When they go to the left, they don't have that luxury.
In the second half here, we'll talk a little bit about the type of person that can come in here and coach, what the profile of a coach at Minnesota could be, what they have here, what they need from the players, and how they might go get them.
I'd be interested to get your thoughts on that, because it is a quandary for a program to, as Weber is under pressure, almost spun out of trouble, but was taken down on a corner blitz from Travis Howard, number 18. Again, we'll talk about this later, but do you go for a high-profile guy, a name, to bring in top-quality recruits, or do you go for one of the up-and-coming offensive or defensive coordinators?
All right, you and I go all over the country calling football games. We've seen a variety of places and the bling that most of these big schools have. Minnesota has a fantastic city to sell from.
Sure do.
A family environment. Bill Snyder, Kansas State, has sold. You come to Manhattan, Kansas, and we've got a family here. We're going to take care of you. It's family first, and we'll build on that here in just a moment.
Weber.
Had
his backup quarterback, Gray, open, hit him, and now there's a flag down in the secondary. Jermail Hines was covering him. There you see the officials talking it over. I mean, this was third and very long.
During the play, personal foul. Face mask. Number 7, defense, 15 yards, automatic first down.
Hines, who had the coverage, is the man who gets the flag.
You know what I liked about this play was that Weber bought time, stayed back there, looking for a receiver to come open, and clearly Hines did have a face mask on the receiver. I like this Marquise Gray, the number
too.
Two quarterback. I mean, I like how he moves back there, and just a huge body that can get open and use his body to stay open.
That was a third and 17 gift. And Hines, trying to make up for his error, comes up and gets Eskridge.
So you know, when you think about Minnesota, they have history here. It's just been a while since it's been productive in 04 with their last bowl game. So you build on a family aspect, whoever that head coach comes in, that has that really stresses the character of the family here, the city here, the quality of life here, the campus here.
And this stadium, Mike, what do you think about it? I love this place.
Oh, this is magnificent. But you can't use the history. The last national championship was 1960.
Some recruiting coach.
I mean, none of the recruits are 50 years old.
Some recruiting coordinator will be talking about national championships of the past.
They tried to get the quick hitter out to McKnight, threw it too high to him. But the fact that they have won six national championships is a great bonus when you're walking through the Hall of Fame. But this is the thing that's going to lure a lot of guys, this TCF Bank Stadium. The way they cant the seats toward the field, you get perfect views with everything. The locker rooms are magnificent, and it is the first new palace built in the Big Ten in the last 50 years.
I think it needs to be a coach that's built before and that understands this part of the country for recruiting.
Weber throws for the goal line, should have been intercepted, knocked down by Gant. Had it right in his hands at the goal line.
Yeah, I'm not so certain that this isn't a ball that if you look down there and you see five white jerseys, there's somebody else that's underneath that buys you a little more running space.
Really not going to be able to force that one in there, are you?
No, there's just too many different jerseys. And remember now, this is a Minnesota team that missed a chip shot field goal early on in the first quarter.
Elstad hit the upright on his first try, 35. This time he's good from 33. So Minnesota gets on the board, but they're still down 31-10 third quarter. The last time Minnesota beat Ohio State here in Minneapolis, all the way back in 1981, the Buckeyes came in ranked 18th behind All-American quarterback Art Schleister, but the Gophers rode the arm of their quarterback, Mike Hollensey, who was 37 of 64 for 444 yards and five, count them, five touchdowns in Minnesota's 35-31 win.
I played with Hollensey in the USFL, Washington Federals. We didn't have so many wins in that era. I think we were the worst team in the history of football. 3-15. Whoa, we were terrible. Then Lee Corso got the coaching job after I left and got, fortunately, to New England. Whew.
Berry on the return for Ohio State across the 30 to the 33. Here's Robert Flores.
All right, Mike, here's what's happening on SportsCenter right now, presented by Sprint. The Texas Rangers are on the board in the 2010 World Series. Neftali Feliz getting the final out, striking out Juan Uribe. First postseason save for him. They are still down 2-1 in this best of seven. And Brett Favre telling ESPN's Ed Werder that he does, in fact, plan on starting Sunday against the New England Patriots despite the bad ankle.
That would extend that unbelievable starting streak he has, and I don't think he's doing it for his own ego. He's doing it because it's the best choice. Straight up the middle goes Brandon Sane. Now in the backfield for the tailback, Dan Heron. And if you're a sports fan, had been a lot of fun in the Twin Cities in October. The Twins came apart. They were swept by the Yankees. The Vikings obviously have struggled, and the Gophers have struggled more than anybody. They fired their coach on October the 16th. All you can do right now is look forward to snow, huh?
Well, November's Monday morning. New month, new opportunity.
That's the optimist in Craig James coming out again. Sane, unable to get outside. He's wrapped up by the linebacker, Mike Rollis.
Ray Bentley, you down there, man? How are those guys? I mean, the sidelines are still Gophers standing up. Nobody's on the bench, generally.
Yeah, you know what, though? They've lost a lot of the air. The excitement that you felt and the intensity early on, that's kind of gone out the window here a little bit.
Pryor in the shotgun. Blitz coming, they pick it up. Pryor throws incomplete. Intended for Sonsenbacher. but he missed him badly.
Man, after being so accurate in the first half, just a bad ball here. He throws that out so well. The out ball that.
Statistically, he's thrown for 158 yards. Heron has had a big first half, 114. And Posey has already caught six balls. This is third and 13. Four-man rush. Pryor with time, throws Posey again. Inside the 30, 25, down to the 22, fumble the ball. They may rule the ground caused it. Stottermeyer whipped him to the turf. Minnesota saying they still have. I have not seen a ruling on the field as yet, and that's critical.
The runner was down, first down, Ohio State.
Well, that takes care of that. It's 28 yards.
As bad as the previous throw was, this one was just as good. Ball still tucked. He's down enough. Yeah, he's down. That's a good call on the field.
And it looked like when his elbow hit is when the ball came out, but his knee was already down.
It looks like the ball is still secured just before the knee, or as the knee's hitting the ground.
Well, Minnesota, of course, anxious for any kind of a break it could possibly get.
Minnesota is challenging the ruling on the field. Ruling on the field is the runner was down. First down for Ohio State.
They will review it while we take a break. We'll be back to Minneapolis in a moment.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. Find our fares online only at southwest.com. John Hancock, the future is yours. And Chevrolet.
This was from yesterday in Avoca, Minnesota, about 20 miles north of Minneapolis. The parade is called the Little People Parade, where children get to show off their Halloween costumes. Avoca is known as the Halloween capital of the world, a city that really embraces the event.
See, just another recruiting tool that you have here at Minnesota.
The play was upheld, so the big game goes Ohio State's way. Scratching its draws. Pryor goes to Sonsenbacher on the flanker screen, and he's taken down by Stottermeyer as he reaches the 16.
But how about that last throw, though, the one that was under review, how accurate that ball was right over a corner who had tried to drop back into coverage.
He is a talented quarterback, there's no doubt about it. Had off-season arthroscopic knee surgery, injured a quad earlier this year. And straight up the middle goes Sane. His mechanics, I mean, even to the untrained eye, are so much better than they were a year ago. And this kid has really worked hard to try to get better. He came to Ohio State, remember, instead of going to Michigan where he could have run the spread, because he wanted to learn how to be a pocket passer and a pro quarterback. And that's what he can learn at Ohio State.
Let's watch the footwork on that last really nice ball on the end. Look at his feet, how he steps up into it, delivers over the top. I mean, those are the mechanics that are making him a solid all-around player.
Sane again inside the 10. Collado makes a stop. And Pryor in total offense has already gone over the 7,000 yard mark, making him only the third player ever to go over 7,000 yards. And with 7,233, he is in second place behind only Arch Schleister. Second and 10, Sane, nowhere to go. Minnesota right in the middle of that running play.
You know, you see those numbers on Terrell Pryor. Ray, he's only a junior, and I haven't heard anything about him wanting to come out early.
No.
I think the guy comes back, right?
I do, too.
Yeah, absolutely. He comes back, Craig. And if he continues to improve like he has over his career thus far, he could probably be a favorite for the Heisman, at least a front runner going into next season. You know, I think he's really improved his intermediate throws. It's the short ones now that he has a problem with. And I think it's because his arm's too long. Does that make any sense to you?
No, but I'll go with you.
All right.
Sonsenbacher at the 5, dives to the 4. They need to reach the 2 for a first down.
I'll try to work with you on that, Ray, though, but I think some of that, it has to be with the speed, the quickness of a throw, perhaps.
Yeah.
So if he speeds his body mechanics up and the tempo of that, maybe that helps it.
Yeah, and I just think with the length of the arm and having to make those quick short throws, and he tries to force it, and almost, you know, you hear baseball pitchers talk about aiming instead of throwing. I think he aims those little short ones instead of just throwing them.
Yeah. Of course, you played linebacker and I played running back.
Yeah. Neither of us know what we're talking about.
Barclay on for the point after, and he missed it, or for the field goal, and he missed it. Barclay from 21 yards misses only his third field goal try of the year. And something for the Minnesota fans to celebrate as the defense stiffens and Barclay complies with a missed field goal. The missed field goal by Devin Barclay keeps the score at 31-10. Minnesota and quarterback Adam Weber take over at the 20. Eskridge is the tailback. Lair, the tight end, has been strangely quiet. It's been effective all year. There's a run of about a 1 for Eskridge. Chris Berman hosts ESPN's popular 2-hour pregame show on Sunday. Get all the news and the latest updates from stadiums around the league right until kickoff. Sunday NFL Countdown presented by IBM on ESPN at 11 a.m. Eastern. Five minutes, 48 seconds to go, third quarter. Since it was 7-7, Ohio State has dominated this game. Play action by Weber. Goes out to Bryant Allen, who has caught 14 passes this year. Also a player on Tubby Smith's basketball team from Minnesota. Nathan Williams made the tackle.
Well, Nathan Williams doesn't play basketball, but he's made the last two plays in this game. He's really good. 260 pounds, got down the line on a run to the left side a while ago. Came from the backside, ran the runner down. Out in the space that time. I mean, that's pretty darn athletic.
He's become a full-time player after being a situational pass rusher. Weber under pressure, down he goes. He didn't have a chance. Brian Roll came in there and swallowed him up. Although Roll was about the third guy to go by him, Williams was the first.
Yeah, that's a pretty darn good series there by number 43, Williams. He first forces Weber up right into the arms of his teammate so that the sack goes by Roll. But man, what a, that's defense. That's a,
yes,
that right
is.
There was getting after him.
So Minnesota gets the break and can't take advantage of it. Jordan Hall is back for Oreskes' kick. And Ohio State football in the end zone, still loose. And Ohio State's got a touchdown. So the Buckeyes get a break on special teams, turn it into a touchdown.
Yeah, that's just a poor snap, timing off, and there's no way that the punter can get the ball off. Then it's a scramble in the end zone for
Domacone is there, and he recovers. And it looks like the ball was knocked away by John Newsom, outside linebacker who was filling in for Andrew Sweat, who moved to the weak side. Point after is good.
Ray, we were talking about how after those great locker room speeches, we all come out as players and they kind of wear off. It's so hard, isn't it, to play every snap of the game against a really good opponent.
Boy, that was a low snap, and Oreski did a nice job of fielding it on the short hop, but could not get the kickoff.
Special teams having a nice night for Ohio State. Had a really good punt return earlier, have the blocked punt for a touchdown. Build all three phases, and again, we said this at the beginning. Right now, there are four teams tied with one loss in the Big Ten. At the end of this mess of the season, if it stays all wadded up, the highest-ranked BCS team would go on to represent the Big Ten. And Ohio State well-positioned for that.
There are some other tiebreaker procedures, but more than likely it would come down to the BCS. Stoudemire on the return, gets to the outside, still on his feet. Stoudemire out to the 48-yard line. Nice return. Let's take a look at the standings and give you an idea of what we're talking about, because now Michigan State, Wisconsin, Ohio State, and Iowa all have one loss. And probably the biggest factor in this is that Michigan State and Ohio State are not going to play each other down the stretch. So they could end up being tied. There would be no head-to-head tiebreak.
Yeah, we put together a schedule of each one of those four teams who are tied now in their remaining games. Michigan State and Wisconsin look like they've got the easiest path towards winning out.
Eskridge, nice hole up the middle, drives forward to the Ohio State 45-yard line.
Because Ohio State has to still play at Iowa, so that's going to be a really, really good football game. And but you're looking clear, pretty simple path to three teams being tied.
Yeah,
with one loss in the Big Ten.
It looks like that's the way it's going to come out. They used to have the rule where the last team that hadn't gone to the Rose Bowl would be the one to go. That is no longer the case.
And you know, the BCS was not created to help solve tiebreakers in conference play. And so, you know, that can become a sticking point. And the reason I say that Ohio State's sitting where they are nicely, they're the highest ranked right now after Michigan State got beat. So just got to win and win impressively as they are doing tonight.
Of course, you want something that could mess up the BCS standings. USC just went ahead of Oregon 32-29. That could throw a log jam in the works.
USC, we did one of their games. They are so close to being undefeated.
Yep. Weber, Roll knocked him down. Ball is loose. Boy, Brian Roll got hurt early in this ball game. Took him a while to get off the field. Didn't look like he would come back, but he recovered completely, and he's made some big plays since. He came in that time and drilled Weber, knocked the ball loose, and then appeared to be the guy who got it back.
Yeah, you know what, and this is a four-man rush, but then the linebacker, as soon as the back decides to block, Roll decides to rush, and Weber did not get rid of the football, and he paid the price for it. Imagine even Ray Bentley liked that hit down there on the sidelines.
Yeah, that one felt pretty good from here. That's the old green dog, Craig. I used to love that when you've got the back man-to-man, and you kind of know he's going to stay in and protect anyway, so you bait him into it and become that extra rusher and make something happen.
Yeah, but Ray, now I was a running back, so I used to always study to make sure that I'd look behind you, a linebacker, to see if somebody crept over there to cover. So if I saw you trying to do that, I would run my route, and you'd have to blitz peel to go find me in the flat.
So you were one step ahead of me all the way then.
No, I wonder. We both, we're probably about 50-50.
Yeah, that's probably about right.
Ray, I think what he's trying to tell you, he didn't want to stand in the pocket in front of the quarterback and block you.
No. Yeah, I don't blame him for that one. No. And I didn't want to go run down the field and have to cover him either.
Ray wouldn't have liked me as a blocker on linebackers, because I was going trying to cut him. I wouldn't stand up high. I'd give him the old here comes the blade.
Yeah. They're reviewing this last play to see if Weber was down or if his arm was coming forward. Obviously, it wasn't coming forward. He may have been down before that ball came out.
Indisputable video evidence. I'm not sure that this angle here, this shot, shows us if his backside is down while still in control of the football.
Well, he sure got a helmet-to-helmet shot.
Sometimes, though, it's not an intentional helmet-to-helmet. I mean, I think that Roll was coming in to make a play.
I understand that completely, but the rule doesn't say anything about intentional.
I know.
And we're always going to have guys who are ducking to avoid contact and get drilled with the helmet. If you are going to protect players, you're going to have to call it without any regard to whether it was intentional or not.
You're right. I haven't seen any indisputable video evidence yet that says he was down, still in possession of the ball.
Well, that was awfully close. But indisputable is going to be tough to prove.
Hey, if USC hangs on and beats Oregon,
that opens up a can of worms for Boise State and TCU again, doesn't it?
After further review, the play stands as ruled on the field. Ball was fumbled, recovered by Ohio State.
I mean, how many teams have to lose in front of Boise State and TCU for somebody to finally say, "Hey, guys, they're the only ones left standing"?
Okay, but.
I'm being devil's advocate
here. I understand, and I believe we've got this emotional vacuum in this country for Cinderella that's pulling voters to vote for them. And they're neglecting to look at it as Oregon is losing to USC.
Hall is in a tailback. A lot of speed. Tries to get outside. Turns the corner. Let's go to Robert Flores. Robert?
Mike, did someone mention Boise and TCU? Because this could be some good news for both of those schools and other teams behind number two Oregon in the BCS. USC gets a nice punt return from Ronald Johnson. The penalty flag was on the Ducks. That sets up Matt Barkley for the one-yard plunge, and USC leading 32-29 at the Coliseum.
Mike? Repeat, first down.
Thank you, Robert. The penalty is going to go against Ohio State. And back to our discussion. Craig, I'm not saying Boise State and TCU deserve to vault to the top of the BCS standings simply because a team like Oregon lost. I'm saying from the outside, unless you are steeped in college football, people that are just casual fans are going to say, how long are you going to shut these guys out? They're the ones that are still winning. Everybody else is losing, and you say, they're not good enough.
Yeah.
Pryor with time, throws, and it's complete to Corey Brown. Stottermeyer makes the tackle.
Well, okay, here's where I think I become a fan of computers, because computers are looking at strength of schedule. Who did you play? And they're going to recognize these once beaten teams like Michigan State going to Iowa. They're going to see that Oregon had to play a USC team that has played and beaten some good teams. They're going to see all of these things. So the computers are not emotional.
No, but the computers are only good enough as the programmers who put the stuff in them to start with. And some of those guys, I think, have deficits in those programs.
Yeah, but and the computers are only a third, right? So you've got the Harris and the coaches that are another third, two-thirds out there.
Right.
And that's the emotional vacuum I'm talking about. And I think that the country's getting swept up, these voters getting swept up in Cinderella. And you got to stay to the discipline. At least I'm going to try. I'm going to look at who did you play, how are you playing, the strength of what you've done in the football season, the body of work. I'm going to stick to my guns when I look at and evaluate teams.
I don't disagree, but how can you look at two ugly stepsisters and not vote for Cinderella?
Pretty easy. And I'm not saying I won't vote for Boise State and TCU, because they still win. They're still
Ohio
winning
State
football games. But there is that glass ceiling that is called a schedule and who you're playing. And you've got to recognize that. And Baylor beating Texas right now, for instance. You know, if Baylor hangs on and wins and continues out strong, that says a lot to me about TCU, who smoked Baylor.
Yeah.
So I look at the body of work.
Well, after his win last weekend, Denny Hamlin finds himself only 6 points behind Jimmy Johnson. They don't vote for this. They race for it. Now the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup continues with the AMP Energy Juice 500 at Talladega on ESPN tomorrow at 1 Eastern. Love those 2.5 mile tracks.
Hey, Ray. Hey, Ray.
Yeah.
Okay, so in this conversation here about this, where do you weigh in on strength of schedule, quality of opponents, having to gear it up in a conference that's challenging every week?
I think that's definitely got to be a factor, but it's hard for me to look past those undefeated records. If you've got, you know, TCU and Boise as, you know, the last two standing, or maybe one other team, I think you have to at some point put those guys in the game and let them play and let's find out.
Go to Hall on the screen, beautifully diagnosed by Minnesota. Gary Tinsley, the middle linebacker, peeled back and made the tackle.
Yeah, Ray, but here's the deal, and I have zero doubt that TCU, Utah, or Boise could beat anybody in the country on any given Saturday. Mm-hmm. No doubt at all. But, Ray, they aren't beat up. They haven't gone through a month of October like Michigan State just did and then had to go in at the end of the month after four strong games and play at Iowa.
Yeah, I can't argue with that, because there's a lot of merit to that week in and week out. That's, you look at the SEC teams that keep knocking each other off. That's a tough one to go through.
Fair catch made at the 11. Minnesota will take over from there. A 30-yard punt. Well, you know, the one thing is, we take a look at the BCS standings. You hear people say, well, it's not their fault that they play in a weak conference. No, it's not their fault that they play in a weaker conference. But you can't give them credit for it either.
Bring you with me to the BCS countdown show tomorrow night. You make that comment. I seem to be this guy that's taking the side of the automatic qualifiers. I'm just trying to be real about the deal.
Eskridge. I thought it was over, actually, in the second week of the season when Virginia Tech lost to James Madison. To me, that doomed the whole scenario of somebody from a non-BCS qualifying conference.
Yeah. And the point I make about Baylor.
Or a non-automatic.
Not automatic.
You're right.
And my point on the Baylor deal, if they hang on and beat Texas and they continue where they are, and what that does, it comes out of nowhere to support TCU. TCU's they've given up, 10 points in the last four games?
Yeah.
Ooh, they're good.
Well, there's the tight end, Eric Lair, a little quick off the line.
Ball start. Offense, number 85. 5 yards. The down remains second.
Now they will wind the clock, and that's the end of the third quarter. This presentation of Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines, will continue after this message and a word from our ABC stations. But Terrell Pryor has played trick-or-treat against the Minnesota defense, and Ohio State's on top 38-10. Gophers take over from the 11-yard line. Spirits are still reasonably high in the folks that are left. Weber with plenty of time, deep down the middle, incomplete, knocked away on a double team intended for McKnight, and Devon Torrance was there. Dancing with the Stars, the number one show of the new season on ABC Monday. We're celebrating the 200th episode. Your favorite stars from seasons past return to dance and to judge in an incredible star-studded event. It all happens live Monday at 8, 7 Central on ABC. And one of these years, I'm going to turn on Dancing with the Stars, and you are going to be here.
Let me tell you, I just gave a little Sweet Caroline Neil Diamond in here, didn't I? That goes something like maybe Lady Gaga.
It's not singing with the stars. Oh. It's dancing with the stars. Weber, screen, tight end. 2 yards. Well-designed play, but Brian Roll sniffed it out and took down Eric Lair, the young man who had played so well this year as the tight end and has been virtually invisible tonight in this Minnesota offense.
Yeah, you know, another sign of a dominant defense is third down, right? That's the money play today for third downs. Minnesota 0 for 8.
Ohio State puts pressure on again.
Oh.
Hall drilled for his trouble at midfield. Zero on the return after a punt of 33, and I do mean zero.
So Jeffrey in the end zone, got it! Touchdown! South Carolina has knocked off number one.
Hillary to the 40, front race to the house. Touchdown, Wisconsin!
For the second straight week, the number one team goes down.
That's McGaffey breaking free, has a seam. The kicker can't trip him up. Will it be back-to-back weeks? Yes!
Another number one has bitten the dust.
Number one teams are going to be delighted to have October be done with and hope that November is better.
You know, hidden outside of the top handful of teams in the country are the Florida State losses, the Miami loss. The schools there in the middle of the pack losing today.
Ohio State will start from the Minnesota 49. And let's take a look at the Sony big picture. And Auburn, number one, beats Ole Miss on the road by 20. They are for real, but Michigan State got drilled at Iowa, 37-6, and Nebraska eliminated Missouri from the ranks of the unbeaten with a 31-17 beating. And Hall with a carry. He'll be about 5 yards shy of a first down. Stoudemire, who's played pretty well at the corner, came up and made that tackle.
I think I'm most surprised today by, of those three, how strong Auburn was at Ole Miss. You know, I keep looking for that dud game, and they might tell you our dud game was earlier in the year, maybe at Mississippi State or somewhere else, but this is a young team. I mean, I went and spent time with Gene Chizik in the spring. He was still trying to figure out whose quarterback was going to be. You know,
well, he found him, didn't he?
He found the guy, and so every week that Newton gets better, so does their defense.
Third down, 5, Pryor. Trying to run for it, got right out of a tackle, 40, 35, dives to the 31-yard line. He is so strong when he runs.
God. He's deceptive, isn't he? Pryor is something else when he runs, and so is the other number two down in the south, Cam Newton. Just phenomenal what he's done running the football, on pace to throw for 1,000 and a rush for 1,000 and throw for 2,000 and just rewrite the books for quarterbacks in that conference.
He's basically come out of nowhere. First down, Ohio State at the 31. Pryor, plenty of time, floats it out to Hall in the flat. Got a block inside the 20, knocked out of bounds.
You know what? Hey, Ray, that is that touch pass, that short range little arch ball that allows the runner to keep going at full speed.
Yeah, that was really nice touch on that one. And, you know, you take another look at it here, and you see how he's all set. I mean, once he gets his body set, he doesn't have a problem. It's when he has to get rid of it quickly, and it's pretty much all arm. That's when he gets a little errant with those throws.
Another first down, Ohio State at the 18-yard line. Hall, the tailback, picks up a couple. 11 minutes, 49 seconds on the turning clock. Tinsley, middle linebacker, made another tackle.
Cam Newton also had a touchdown pass today and reception, I'm told. So, you know, he's just all over the place.
What, no punt return?
I don't know. The stats might not all be in.
Hall Beautiful Hall off the left side. Hall inside the five, touchdown. Got a burst, doesn't he? Nice block from Posey on the outside, the wide receiver.
Yeah, again, this is just a beautiful job of execution up front by the offensive line and the fullback and the receivers on the outside blocking, runners being patient, doing their job.
They are in the top 25 in rushing in the country, in the top 20 in total offense, number 6 in the country in scoring offense. They've exceeded their average, which is 40.8. Tonight, they are going for 45 and have it. And 6 different Buckeyes have scored touchdowns tonight. This one belongs to sophomore Jordan Hall.
Saturday Night Football on ABC, presented by Southwest Airlines. Find our fares online only at southwest.com. Liberty Mutual Insurance, responsibility, what's your policy? And Ford F-Series, America's best-selling brand of trucks for 33 years straight. Built Ford tough.
This is the 23rd annual Knights of Columbus Haunted House. It's in Avoca, Minnesota, the Halloween capital of the world. Kids from nearby Coon Rapids High School playing all the ghosts and goblins at the haunted house to scare the kids and tame the kids. Nice job.
Are we going to go out later?
As what?
We got to do something.
Why don't you dress up twice for me? Stoudemire from the 5. Kid's got some skills across the 30, 35. Take a look at our Pac Life game summary. And the Ohio State Stars have come out to shine again, as expected. Terrell Pryor, 277 total yards.
He's led a
pretty touchdown.
Pretty balanced attack tonight. 226 running, 222 pass, 3 touchdowns running, 2 touchdowns passing.
Heron went over 100 yards in the first half, and Devere Posey has over 100 yards receiving, which puts him over 600 for the season as a wide receiver. He and Sonsenbacher have done the majority of that. Eskridge gets banged around like a pinball machine and picks up a couple of yards. Ohio State's only stumble this year at Wisconsin. They lost 31-18. And they came out and refocused last week and put up 49 points on Purdue. They're putting up 45 points tonight on Minnesota. The Buckeyes are going to get a defensive touchdown. John Simon, 28 yards with the recovery. Chimdi Chekwa knocked it loose. Brewer from his right side never saw him as he was focused downfield.
And you know what? Chekwa comes late after the snap, then comes, and you know, Weber just didn't see him, didn't feel it, had no idea that the pressure was coming from his right side.
And people who have never stood there don't understand how they can come from a side where if you turn your head, you could see him, and they don't see him. It's because he is focused downfield. And that guy is coming out of his peripheral vision and got quite a shot on him. So now Ohio State has raised the ante to 52-10.
Well, we came on the air talking about Ohio State needing to come out and play well on the road and to be impressive because voters will be watching. I mean, people pick the papers up tomorrow and they'll look at this and they'll say, okay, 52-10 as of now. It could get worse. That's impressive.
Welcome back to ESPN on ABC Saturday Night Football, presented by Southwest Airlines, the Ghosts and Goblins. Happy. Yeah, you like Halloween until you find out the other guys are dressed as Ohio State football players.
Well, yeah. I like that. I tell you what, our production crew got dressed up pretty quickly for that shot.
They're dressed up?
Yeah, Marty and the gang, they did a quick turnabout.
Stoudemire from the 10. Got it to the outside, pushed out of bounds at the 35.
Coming up next, except on the West Coast, your late local news over on ESPN SportsCenter after the conclusion of Michigan and Penn State. And at last check, that was going all Nittany Lions.
Let's talk about these four teams who are tied in the Big Ten. How about that? And look at, you know, for instance, Wisconsin. We did a game of theirs early against Arizona State, and they had some special teams issues. Almost cost them, but they survived and they won. I thought the special teams hurt them against Michigan State. We did that game, they lost.
Weber on the flanker screen to Bryant Allen. And he only gets back to the line of scrimmage.
They solved their special teams issues and they beat Ohio State. Brett Bielema's got a good football team.
Yes, he does.
And he's got a balanced attack. He's got J.J. Watt over on defense that just wreaked havoc on Ohio State.
I may have been a little late to the Iowa bandwagon this year, but the way they handled Michigan State today, that was very impressive.
Yeah, it was really impressive.
Second and 10, Eskridge. Where even the Ohio State reserves just make it tough for this team to be able to run the ball. Garrett Goble made that tackle. Let's bring you up to date on some of those Big Ten scores. And Northwestern escaped Indiana. There was the big one. Iowa crushing number 5 Michigan State, 37-6, taking them from the ranks of the unbeaten. Illinois, which has played really good football, rolled it up on Purdue and Penn State in the fourth quarter. Michigan's back within a touchdown.
You're right. And how about Ron Zook, what he's done at Illinois?
Yes, sir.
A few of their games last year, and he was, you know, day to day on a resuscitator.
Weber, quarterback draw, dives forward, takes a hit as he gets to the 45. I like this kid. He is tough. He has thrown for over 10,000 yards, one of only 5 quarterbacks in the history of this great conference to do it. He's taken a lot of heat locally and in the Big Ten, but when you don't have complementary players around you, I don't care how good a quarterback you are, you can't get it done by yourself.
Whoever the coach is that comes in here wishes that Mr. Weber had one more year.
Yes, sir, or two more. Ray, what do you think of Weber? You've been able to see these Big Ten teams several times.
Yeah, I think he's a solid player, and I think that he's a better person. You know, everything you hear about him with all that criticism that you were talking about that he faces here and all those things, everyone we talk to says he never puts the blame on anybody or, you know, takes that stuff the wrong way. He handles it like a man. He stays positive. His attitude has been great throughout this whole thing. And that's what I look for. And I think he might have a chance to maybe do something at the next level, get in there as a third string guy and develop a little bit.
Well, Jeff Horton, Ray, who was the interim head coach, of course, head coach in the pros at both Detroit and St. Louis, and says he thinks he's got a shot. Not perhaps as a starter, but as a guy that can go in there and make a ball club. And quarterback is probably the most crying need in the National Football League. There just aren't enough of them. And there you see his numbers as he continues to gain on Chuck Long, only 100 yards behind him in the passing department. And he could easily move up to third all time next week. Takes off again. Breaking tackles. And down to the 33. Man. And to me, you know, it takes a special kind of guy. I mean, Weber right now could go to the sideline and opt out of this. It's going to be a 1-8 record. He's taken a pounding. He's taken a couple of shots that would knock most guys out and say, hey, you know, I might be done for the night. But he's not.
He's the leader of this team. You admire him for being out there and running. And he only gets so many shots, 12 games that you get to play each season. And I admire him as well for what he's doing. And he's getting a chance to play against one of the top 10 teams in the country.
Yep. Kerryou fell as the player that was shaken up, the right guard. Started his career at Notre Dame and transferred.
As this drive started in this half, seven drives from Minnesota, 23 yards. I mean, this has been domination by Ohio State's defense. Those numbers, that those rankings that they have, are going to do nothing but enhance.
Eskridge fighting for extra yardage. The flag is down as he got to the 27-yard line. Thrown right on top of the pile. Clock's worked its way down to 6 minutes and 17 seconds to go.
Personal foul, face mask, defense number 98. Have to just throw the goal, automatic first down.
That'll add 15 to it. Every Sunday, catch the BCS Countdown Show for the exclusive unveiling of the new BCS rankings. They'll sure be interesting this week. Find out who's in the driver's seat, who is poised to be this year's BCS buster. The BCS Countdown Show, presented by Vizio, tomorrow, 8:15 Eastern on ESPN. It continues at 9 on ESPNU. Craig James will be there.
I love that show because it pays off the week. And it's you can't really script it, edit it. You don't know. It's Santa Claus revealing, and I just enjoy the heck out of it.
Whistles will stop this play. It looked like the center, DJ
Ball Burris. Ball starts. Offense number 53, 5 yards. The down remains first.
And it was. He is making his 16th straight start tonight. He's been a very good player in the middle of that offensive line. Yeah, you talk about admiring guys. The more I do this, the more I admire offensive linemen. These guys just get banged up constantly. Their fingers are gnarled, their knees are busted up. There they are.
That old saying, when you get to it and you can't do it, call the O-line, they're used to it.
Eskridge, nice fake to get outside, but there's another defender waiting for him right there. Leighton took one of his shoes off at the 19-yard line. Gotta be honest with you, I never heard that one.
I'm glad that I was able to share here on this trick-or-treat night. One for the O-line.
That was a treat.
I always hung out with those guys. I knew where I got my bread and butter.
Yeah, that's smart. Of course, Ray just pounded on those guys when he could.
How about Minnesota? Admiring this offense, not giving up their longest drive in plays in time tonight. Still playing hard.
All the coaches said that's what they have done. They have practiced hard, studied hard, played hard, and had a great attitude. Trying to make the most of a bad situation with their season, which I think they had a lot more invested in than a lot of people expected to happen. But after that opening win that they got, the loss to South Dakota in the second week just about did it. And look at Murderer's Row that they have left. Michigan State, who's going to be a little bit upset after what happened last week, then a really good Illinois team, and then Iowa. Thanks so much.
It's the Big Ten. I mean, that's just
Weber for the corner. Boy, that could have been easily a flag on Travis Howard as he was guarding McKnight. It looked like he rode him out of there a little bit.
Yeah, but you know, like we were talking about, Ray Bentley in his film study was saying about how you get down here in this red zone, and Ray, they like to throw that ball up on the outside, that little fade going, don't they?
Yeah, this is one of their favorite plays when they get down in this area because they love the athleticism of McKnight and Gray. Both of them have done a good job catching that fade ball in the corner.
Well, Howard used great technique to sort of get a hip into McKnight and ride him out of there so he couldn't continue his pattern. Fourth down, they're obviously going to go for it. Weber sitting in the pocket, same pattern, corner, no. McKnight had to spin around, Doe couldn't come up with it. And McKnight slow to get up. 3:50 to go. Ohio State rolling 52-10. Back to ESPN and ABC Saturday Night Football presented by Southwest Airlines. Guys in our truck being kind enough to have a little trick or treat for some of the kids around the stadium here. I'm sure our director Patrick McManus and our producer Scott Matthews didn't scare him too much.
Brett Favre in the truck looking for a new foot.
Ohio State will take over at the 350 mark. Boserman has committed quarterback. And Terrell Pryor comes out, and we've got a new tailback. And it's Carlos Hyde, the true freshman, 238 pounds. Take a look at tonight's Southwest Airlines playbook.
How about Terrell Pryor? He started off the dance touchdown, and they just kept moving along. Posey there had one. They had the block punt. Another touchdown, and all seven different Buckeyes to the pay dirt.
And Pryor was 18 out of 22 for 222 yards, rushed for another 55. Hyde got some giddy up, breaks a tackle across the 30 to the 34-yard line out of Naples, Florida.
I don't think they're they're not too many poor or average players on the Buckeyes football team.
No, they don't get fill-ins. Hey,
I
want to
say something that I think is unique and really good that Jim Tressel does. He has I think it's eight different encouragers. They're former, you know, most of them are former coaches, and they have players they're assigned to go monitor to make sure they're going to class and encourage them in life in general.
Barry trying to break tackles out to the 37.
So I was there a couple of springs ago watching this take place, and like Beanie Wells at the time, like, say, he was like, you know, Mr. James, what do you mean I didn't go to class today? Well, those encouragers are going to go to class every day to see if you're there. It could be at the beginning, the middle, or the end of class. You don't know when your encourager is going to show up at class. So they make sure that you get into class, and if you don't, and you have a problem, well, we're going to talk about it. And it's kind of a demerit system. And if you really get bad, you start losing tickets to games, playing time. We got to go see Coach Tressel together. It keeps you accountable.
Yes, it does.
I like that hands-on approach.
Boserman, former minor league baseball player, rolls left, throws right, and got the completed pass to Grant Schwartz, who makes his fifth catch of the yard. Stay tuned, or fifth catch of the game, excuse me. Stay tuned for the Ford wrap-up after the game. Log on to bcstailgate.com for your chance to win the ultimate tailgate 150. Clock running 127. And people will ask, why is Ohio State throwing the football, leading 52-10? I don't mind this. These guys practice all week. They want to play at Ohio State. They are getting their opportunity in the last couple of minutes of this game. Let them play. You agree with that?
100%. It's all in the spirit of what you're trying to accomplish. And Jim Tressel's not trying to run the score.
No, he's not.
Yeah, and Jeff Horton
understands
that.
He'd have had Pryor in there if he wanted to do that. He'd have all of his starters in there.
Yeah, here comes a run.
Hyde is back in there at tailback. Got a block. Cuts it off the left side. Hyde still on his feet. Look at that. He takes a shot in the thighs on a roll block and just sort of bounces off. You might be looking at the future of the running game for Ohio State right here.
We're always looking at their future.
Yeah.
I mean, just a strong guy. But these players, they work hard, just as hard as Terrell Pryor, just as hard as Dan Heron, any of the players that are getting the time.
Darn so, right they do.
Man, this means a lot to the players that are on the field right now.
Barry is back in there at the tailback. He is tripped up. A good effort by Spencer Reeves, the backup middle linebacker, number 8, who reached in, got him by the ankle, and knocked him down. We're under a minute to go here. And Ohio State got, for them, the great news that they were right back in the Big Ten race earlier today when Michigan State was knocked off by Iowa. So there are no unbeaten conference teams left. And four teams with one loss in the Big Ten. And with Ohio State and Iowa with a huge game still coming, we could easily have a three-way tie for first place in the conference.
And that doesn't mean, Mike, that the Big Ten's not a good conference.
Oh, no.
Quite the opposite, right? You know, but people are going to look at it and say, oh, well, nobody out there undefeated. Well, that's because everybody's good.
All right, appreciate it. Thank you.
Good luck to you.
All right.
And Ohio State will go to 8-1. Minnesota falls to 1-8, 0-5 in the conference as they lose to the Buckeyes tonight, 52-10. Who did you say earlier you thought had the easiest path?
Well, I think Michigan State has the easiest path to win out because they play Minnesota, Purdue, and then at Penn State to finish.
Yeah, I would
so
agree.
I think that's the easiest path. You know, you got Wisconsin at Purdue, Indiana, then at Michigan and Northwestern at home. They should handle that. But then Ohio State playing at Iowa.
Tough, boy.
Well, you know, one of those is going down, obviously. Yeah. Playing at Northwestern is not going to be easy either. Northwestern is on Iowa's schedule. They'll host them. They get to end at Wisconsin. So Northwestern's going to have a say in this Big Ten before it's over.
They certainly will. Well, once again, our final score here on campus at Minnesota, the Buckeyes of Ohio State 52, Minnesota 10. For Craig James, Ray Bentley, and our entire crew, this is Mike Patrick saying happy Halloween and so long from Minneapolis. Now we send you back to New York and Robert Flores for the Ford wrap-up show.